Hello, everyone. Today we are continuing talking about building MVP on AWS. And today we will talk about the PostgreSQL. And let's assume that you already decide on PostgreSQL database. Why? Because it's a powerful open source object relationship database system with over 30 years of active development. But today we will leave the problem of where and how to store data for another time. Today we will be focusing only on PostgreSQL and not on other databases or ways to store the data. Inside AWS, we also have Amazon Aurora. It's also PostgreSQL, but with additional benefits. And if you don't have any specific requirements, I can suggest to select Aurora as a default option in AWS. Why that? Because the storage systems are the key difference between RDS Postgre and RDS Aurora Postgre. And for Aurora, you don't need to worry about being out of space. For example, Aurora will help you. Aurora will automatically scale the storage up to 128 terabytes of data. But the key point is not only with out of space. You can deal with that. You can, you know, predict, you can set up an automation and so on. The difference is how the data is stored, because for Aurora, the data is automatically replicated across different locations in AWS cloud. So for example, by default, it's replicated across three different locations, three different places in the world. And with Aurora, we can add the global database and then add another region. And then it means six different places in the world stored. So for me, it sounds like a magic because your data is already distributed and durable, and the durability is become closer to S3 even just by doing that. But before you actually go and set up the Postgre, where the kind of prerequisites? Yes, we can just go and click, then create a database and see what exactly happened. But there is a couple of prerequisites what you're supposed to do before that, because it will save you time in the future. And first of them is to go to Postgre parameters. First, I suggest you to create a custom parameter groups for the instance and for the cluster. Just click create parameter groups, set up your engine, set up the version, and just name it somehow. The names are not that important, just important that you can use the different parameters, because it will allow you to use the customizations for a Postgre engine itself, and it's very, very useful. And for a process of a creation database, let's see what AWS offers us by default. And I can suggest you to go with the standard create and select the whatever is latest version is available. Easy. For template, use a production one, and not use the test. Even if you testing something on it for development, use a production template. I will cover this a bit later. For ID, this will be used inside your connection string. So use something, you know, what you know what is inside, maybe a transactions, for example. For the root username, I can suggest to avoid, you know, Postgres, root, main, or some kind of this word, because they're obvious and everyone will try to enumerate them first. So you can do something pg root or pg mydb or whatever you prefer, but just to understand that you will not use that root username often in the future, because here by default we enable the managed AWS Secrets Manager. It means same, all the passwords will be stored inside Secrets Manager and automatically rotated. And technically it means same, no one will know the secret and the password until they ask the Secrets Manager. It means same, the suggestion here is the use this root user only for management operations. So just go and create another user role inside the Postgre and use that one for your applications. For a cluster storage configuration, we use the production template. So first one, we will not sure about the storage, what we need to use, just use a standard because it's a bit more cost effective. for the instance type, for the startups, I can recommend the smallest Aurora, TG4 medium, just because of the cost. And also another option here, it's serverless V2, which could scale to zero. It means same, if you are unsure completely how you will use the database at the moment, and but you have to accept that serverless V2 cost like is more than just standard T4G medium. But if you are in the development and you develop maybe just 4-8 hours per day, so maybe serverless V2 could be a good option for you for at least understand how you use the database. And this instance classes and instance configuration is completely changeable in the future, so you can do whatever you want in the future. For replica, we don't need that one at the moment. VPC. This is important because by default, AWS suggests us to use default VPC because it's one which exists. But I can always suggest use the custom VPC, create a separate one, create a new one, go to the VPC section, use this very nice constructor for a VPC. It's very easy. It takes like less than 5 minutes to create a VPC. Why that? Because after database is created, you can't change its VPC. It's unchangeable, and you can't move your database out as default VPC if you wish. But it is like it's the common requirements to not use the default VPC and use your own custom under your control, because default VPC time to time used for another services, and there's a common requirement inside the compliance and any many different tools. Just remove the default VPC, and you can't because you have a database there. So just create a separate one, 5 minutes, and you are done. For public access, it's obvious, yes. Please don't use the public access for RDS. Don't attach your public IP addresses for your RDS. And always create a separate VPC security group, even if you not name it right, just a separate one. It's help you to understand like as who exactly have access to database. Even it's very broad configuration, like as the whole VPC IPs, you can change it in the future and you can, you know, modify it and so on. For public access, yes, it's changeable. You can do back and forward, but if you do with a public access and when you use like as a broad open security groups, it's not only not secure because everyone will, you know, try to log in inside your database always all the day, but it's also very hard to understand like as where is your workload exactly. So yes, where is the VPC flow logs, you can catch it, you can go there and here and block it, but it's just a time-consuming thing. And my suggestion is try to not get any public access to database. For the database IAM authentication, I could suggest you to enable that and look inside RDS IAM auth. It's very nice and useful. It's allow to connect without any passwords. The good one for encryption. You can already see the KMS keys, but the most important is actually here. And by default, AWS create the default RDS key, but you can change it in the future. It means same if database is created and storage is encrypted, we can change the encryption key without the recreation for database. And I can suggest you to create a separate custom managed key for RDS. It's also take no more than 5 minutes and save you time in the future. And it's a help not only control the policy of a key and control who can encrypt, decrypt the database, but also follow the compliance and the regulations for future without recreation, stopping, and do some operations on a database. Just simply use non-default key here. Same for the performance inside, just non-default key. For parameter groups, we already talked about that. Select the custom one and you can change them. So, and I think we can also talk about the custom parameters, what we can recommend to tune inside the PostgreSQL. But there are multiple different cases and situation, but I will just cover some basics because there's 400 and more parameters in PostgreSQL and we don't need them all, of course, because RDS actually comes with a very good default parameters. There is a many of them that use the, you know, the variables here. So it means these parameters are tuned depends of instance size and depends of the conditions, which is very nice. But let's talk about some basics, like a lock mean duration statement and its parameter, which allow us to lock statements which are longer than that value. I can suggest around 4,000, 5,000. It's mean same everything. If it's executed longer, will be locked inside the logs. It will help you to catch the longer queries with the details, especially in the beginning of development. Very useful because by default it's disabled. And if it's disabled, it means same, you catch the long query after you have to, you know, go enable that parameter, repeat the case one more time and see what's happened. But just set, you know, 5,000, 4,000 and you are fine. Force SSL. We talked about encryption a bit earlier, but here is about encryption in transit. It means same about the connection to your database from your application. Yes, RDS have a TLS enabled by default, but it's not enforced. It means same all the clients can just ignore it and still connect it to the database and not worry about the TLS at all. I can suggest to set here to 1 and force SSL from day 1 because it will let you fail faster and tune your clients without any additional hassle in the future. So you just already did it and your connection is already encrypted in transit and you enforce it. Another useful here, it's about the extensions of a PostgreSQL. It's a shared preload libraries. Why it's important to talk about it? Because it's require engine restart. If you change the shared preload libraries, it means same you have to go and reboot the engine and then it's pick up a new extensions. There is a PG start statement out of a box, but I can also suggest PG audit, PG cron, and just take a look at the extensions. Maybe you find something useful for your case and you can just enable it from day zero. Another useful is idle in transaction session timeout. And by default, this number is very, very huge. And why it's important? Because when your application sent the query, the transaction to database, and when application usually decide to, you know, cut it by timeout, think same, oh, it's not enough time to respond, maybe a minute, 5 minutes, we don't want to wait longer, and we cut your response. But the database will still process the transaction because the number of a transaction session timeout is huge here. And also it's not allow you to, you know, cut it connection from the server. It's not allow you to understand the long transactions. You don't know which transaction is actually low, long, which transaction is actually overload the server. And time to time, you know, applications have a retry behavior and send one transaction. It's not ended. Database engine still process that, but client get a cutout. So let's send it again and again and again and again. So I can suggest to set up here maybe around 300,000. It's been 5 minutes, for example, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, some reasonable number which helps you to understand the transaction is very long now. And you can cut the connection from the server and you can fail earlier. You can, you know, understand your case. And if it's a test prod environment, for example, you can cut it even faster inside a test environment, because in the prod environment, you usually have a big fancy database, but inside a test environment, you have this tiny one, you know, and they work differently. So if you set a bit different numbers here, you can cut it faster in both environments. Today, we covered the PostgreSQL on RDS Aurora. There are many different options in AWS to store the data. But the most important thing is to start from the problem and then pick up the right tool for it. Thanks for watching.